first sort of asking all of you guys, what's your background? How many of you are interested in video game music or you? Okay. Are you guys more from a film background or?
I don't think it's really
So, yeah, game music is fun. You know, it's one of those things. I got started as a composer, wanted to be a film composer 20 years ago. And it was a good 9 years before I even thought about being a game composer. I was, you know, like laser focused on being a film composer. And I did short films and whatever I could just to be involved in that, and started kind of working my way into, started working for a composer named Joel Goldsmith, who was film TV guy, and started working on the show Stargate SG-1 with him. And then, 11 years ago, I got an opportunity to do something for Lumiere Entertainment. It was sort of an audition. My agent at the time said, hey, would you be interested in working in games? And I said, yes, I love games. I've played games my whole life and thought it would be a cool opportunity. And I've always just kind of, whenever there's a door that's presented itself and an opportunity to do something new, work with new people, or just make music that I haven't made before, I always, entertain that idea and try to, walk through it. So I had the opportunity to audition for this thing. I didn't know what it was for. I didn't have any previous game experience, and I wrote the demo that I did some research to make sure I wasn't just, writing whatever. I kind of listened to some of the World of Warcraft stuff, and they actually had me rescore the first World of Warcraft cinematic, which is was very well known at the time. I had never seen it, so I wanted to be sure I knew what, I'm sure they were looking for something that was similar in that same ballpark. I didn't want to write something completely out of left field, so I did my research, and I rescored this thing, and I sent it, and then, a month or two goes by, and I kind of forget about it, and then I get a call that they want to work with me on it, and it was, again, no previous game experience. At that point, I had not yet recorded with orchestra myself. I had written music that had been recorded by orchestra that somebody else had produced, but I'd never produced my own orchestra session. So all this, brand new things that I kind of went into it, like seeing this as a new opportunity, and it certainly was, and I kind of opened the door for this, really a whole new world of opportunities that it's allowed me to go and conduct, concerts around the world, and just get to work with some really amazing people and really amazing musicians. A lot of it, before that, I was working in low-budget film, and oftentimes the budget, at best, would have the budget for one or two musicians, and the movies weren't that great. So going from that to getting to work with full orchestras and, just really, it was an incredible experience, and I've been grateful that I had that opportunity at the time. Because it's harder now to get into the industry, especially to transition from, the film side of things over, because with the film world, you have all these different, you have to know directors, producers, people that are making movies, people that are creating these opportunities. It's a whole one group of people that has absolutely nothing to do with the other group of people, which is the game industry. So game industry, there's programmers, audio directors, other game composers, people that are making games that are completely separate. So if you know one and have a certain amount of success in one, it doesn't translate into the other. So unless you're at the very top, and if you have like, you're a major, like, composer like Hans Zimmer, who has a household name, then people want him to score their game because it's Hans Zimmer. So it's difficult if you're if you're lower on the chain than Hans Zimmer or someone like that. So I'm lucky that I got in when I did, and if I wonder now if I had to do it now at this point, if it would be if I would have the same success. I don't know. It might have just been right place at the right time. And I don't say that to be discouraging. I just say that the best way to break into the industry is to get to know the people making games and really just immerse yourself in it, you know, go to Game Developers Conference, be there, you know, meet the people, know their names before you even get there, know their faces, you know, look them up, look up the audio directors, the people who are in a position to hire composers. When you get there, you see them, you recognize them, you can go up and say hi, and they'll be able to put a name, a face to the name. So that's just my, just the general idea of how to even approach the idea of feedback. So I'll play you something that I have a score for. Anyone familiar with Overwatch?
No.
So we did these animated shorts. One of the best things about Blizzard is their games aren't just games. They create these this whole world of content, of lore, of these stories that live outside the game. So a game like Overwatch doesn't have a story per se in the game. All the story that is occurred has happened outside in these, you know, short films. So there's a bunch of different characters, all of whom have their own history and their own relationships and sort of visual look, national background, all these different things. And so last year, I got to do the music for this one, which is, you know, it's
I have the score.
Yeah.
If anybody wants to call along while it's playing.
So the score is actually, it sort of picks up towards the end, because it's an 8-minute piece that starts, we had to record it in four parts. I had to write it in four parts, because writing 8 minutes and getting all 8 minutes approved, you know, at some point it's like, okay, we have just this much, the director likes this much, let's send that off to get a creative copy. And, you know, couldn't hold off the entire 8 minutes until everything was signed off on. The ending, which was one of the most important parts, I ended up writing like 2 days before the session. And sometimes that's, you know, it just ends up working out that way. I never planned to do that, but sometimes you get so laser focused on, you know, all the other details that you run out of time. The next thing you know, it's like, okay, the orchestra is going to be there whether I'm ready or not. So, gotta.
Dragon. You must heal. Walk the earth on 2 feet as I do. Find value in humility. Then you will find peace.
You are not the first assassin sent to kill me. And you will not be the last. You are all the Countess Shmarakas, the den of your enemies. This was once my home. Did your masters not tell you who I was?
I know who you are.
Hello.
I know you come here every year on the same day.
Think on that, brother.
PM consoles, May 24th.
Cinematics that I worked on before were at the longest 4 minutes. This is an 8 minute long, animated short film, but it's kind of a whole, taking that the whole cinematic thing to a whole other level. But this is, the cinematics I'm talking about, these are, as far as video games go, this isn't the norm in games. And I'm lucky that I get to do a lot of these cinematics, which kind of relies on my experience in film and TV and working the picture, and then the other half of the time it's in-game music for games, which has a completely different function. You're not lining up to picture, it's a lot more of an adaptive kind of thing. You can experience, you might be doing any number of things in the game, and the music has to kind of cover all those bases. So, it's a dramatically different approach. The actual approach of sitting down and writing it for me is very similar, but I tend to, with things writing a picture like this, it's a matter of kind of finding where the the cuts are going to be, finding a tempo that's going to match all those things, kind of moving with the story as it goes. Whereas a lot of times with in-game music, it's I kind of come up with a thematic idea and just kind of develop it, build it slowly over a period, and then kind of taper it off. So it's a lot more about the musical idea and less about the arc or the story. Or the story, there might be a story to the music, but it's the music is telling the story as opposed to kind of following and telling it with the picture. So that's, it's fun to get to work on both those different things. The process is a lot different because of with things like this, that there are a lot more, there's temp music, there's a lot more oversight, directors and producers, all of whom have very specific ideas about what they want. There'll be a lot of iteration, a lot of going back and forth, and kind of adapting things. In the case of this one, has anyone worked with picture, like written to picture, everyone here? So, one of the fun things about working to picture, especially animation, and I say fun sarcastically because at the what tends to happen in animation is it starts with these storyboarded animatics that look sort of like, they're hand-drawn, and it kind of gives a basic sense of the action of what's happening. This is how they initially present the idea to the people that are going to sign off on it. And then the next step is they start to actually animate it, do 3D animation. And as the final shots start to come in, they often come in looking different enough from the original that the editor will feel like, well, we're gonna have to, let's extend this shot a little bit, let's cut a little bit out. So I found out, even after I had already recorded the orchestra for this thing, that there were 8 or 9 different spots where the timing had changed dramatically. And I had to, put on my music editor hat and, slide tempos here and there, cut bars out here. Actually, some of that happened right before the session, like on the stage. So looking at the picture, realizing, okay, well, I can fix this afterwards, or I can just tell them, okay, let's remove these 2 beats here, slide this over, just kind of find a way to make it fit. And then the end result is hopefully seamless. We can't tell that all those things happened, but I'm bringing this up because I have to adapt this for an upcoming concert performance. So that meant taking all 4 of the parts, combining them into 1 big score, taking the original audio stems and building a click track that matched. And the original click track didn't match at all because a lot of things got slowed down. Things, beats and bars were, I spent 2 full days from morning till night adapting this thing, and making sense of it. So I tried to, when I'm originally writing it, I'm focusing purely on the dramatic, the finished product, how it's going to look in the video and everything, or what I need to do for the session to record it. Not thinking about the next stage, which in this case, there's been concert performances. But I've often now started to think, if I eventually have to conduct this, I might want to think a little more strategically about how bars are structured, how tempos happen and everything. Plus, it makes the session go smoother if you don't have a lot of dramatic jumps in tempo. But that the problem with animation like that is oftentimes it gets animated to a temp track that might have been assembled from various bunch of different pieces of temp music that had different tempos and things. So the kind of the dramatic shifts in tempo might have been built in from the very beginning, and it's hard to skip that. So again, that's the writing the picture side of things. The writing just for the game itself, conceptually, I always try to write something that's kind of gets beneath the surface, and rather than focus on the action on the screen, that I don't know what's going to happen on the screen. So I kind of try to dig a little deeper and find, is there something beneath the surface about the story of the game, the characters in the game, something that I can kind of bring out. And so I don't want to just write generic action music or generic sci-fi music. I try to find, is there something a deeper level to bring to it. And that also helps the writer. If you can find some kind of a concept to hang on to, it's almost a shortcut in a sense, So the initial part of the process is doing a lot of research and kind of coming up with a concept, that, for example, is set in Japan, so it limits the scope of things right away, But it's not your typical, it's sort of a samurai ninja story, but it's also set in the future, so there's some, electronic music involved. It's much as there are a lot of the pentatonic things that are, Asian scales and things like that. As much as there's plenty of that, it's also, sort of told in a more Western kind of orchestral way. So blending all those elements together is how you get the final product. But again, starting out, if I can get myself a toolkit to work with, put in, this, well, I know, based on the nationality of the characters and the location, that it's going to have certain elements like this, bring in some electronic elements because it's, a futuristic thing. And once I start to get that those concepts together, I have a starting point. And then I start to assemble sounds together. The most important part of the process for me is building the palette, the orchestral palette, or the sonic palette. So I have a two Mac Pros. One is running Logic, the other is running VN Ensemble Pro, and I have a bunch of instances of Kontakt in there. And I have my orchestral palette in the one. In the main one that's running the sequencer, I bring in a lot of auxiliary sounds shakuhachi blasts or electronic sounds, different things. Once I have all those, I spend the time assembling all of that. The last thing I want to do while I'm writing is having to stop and dig for a sound. And, of course I still do that, but if I have everything kind of laid out in front of me, I can just quickly grab it. It really speeds up the process later. Plus, during that time, as I'm kind of assembling this sonic palette, I'm also kind of thinking, kind of building the approach in my head before I've written it up. And then once I actually sit down to do it, then the groundwork's been laid. It's not like starting from absolutely nothing. And at least have something to start from. Because the hardest part often is, it's that finding that first note. There's something I was supposed to have started on 2 weeks ago. I'm I don't know what to do with it. With every time I'm successfully able to write and finish something, I start to expect that that's going to be the case next time. Even though with every time there's a certain amount of fear that what if this time I can't do it. So as I'm sitting down to do this one, I have such high hopes for it, but it's like I haven't yet gotten past the writing of the first note, the breaking ground on this thing. So there's always that that initial obstacle of what you do, what's the approach on this one. So any questions so far?
Yes. So in that short and the victory is music in Middle Rush, there's a, when they start opening up, there's this constant of system of how did that integrate into your music? Because that's definitely something that representative of Overwatch. It's futuristic, and you know, how do you integrate that into a story that's in, you know, more oriental presentation?
Yeah, that's a good question. The you know, because the sound of Overwatch came, there was a lot of exploration that happened, you know, in the years before, you know, the original opening cinematic and the museum piece came out. And when I started working on that piece, the museum cinematic, maybe a year or so before it came out, and so there was, we're starting with a brand new IP that, that had no previously established music, except that Derek Duke, the music director on that project, had done a bunch of exploration, kind of trying these different themes, some of which we tried, some worked, some didn't. The end result is sort of a team effort of, like, it starts with a fanfare at the Sand Park Road, and then I wrote the victory theme that happens later on in the piece, and sort of brought all these elements together. A lot of different people were exploring and trying different things. So the electronic stuff, people kind of tried to write futuristic music that wasn't, like, just purely electronic. I mean, there's certainly a lot of that, but there's something very timeless about orchestral music. That, you know, Star Wars is an entirely orchestral score, even though it's, you know, sort of a futuristic movie. But, you know, the orchestra kind of has this timeless thing. This adds this emotion, this grandeur to everything. So, you know, a lot of the sound, sort of obviously a blend of those two, sort of these futuristic elements with the sort of timeless orchestral sound. So to answer your question about the 16th notes, I'm a fan of kind of rhythmically driven music, so a lot of that tends to just pop up in my music. If it's just kind of a not only kind of adds to the excitement, but if you get like a nice groove that happens through a piece, it really kind of helps make everything feel synchronized and feel like a dance. Oftentimes, like in an action scene, I try to, you know, score it like a dance, like the music will kind of, you know, I don't like to have things happen always like right on top of the character. But if you have something that kind of happens between the movements, the moments of, you know, whether it's a fight, there's, you don't want to, you know, hit every punch like that. The first thing I ever scored was at an electronic music class, and my teacher asked me to score a scene from John Club and Bamboo. He had the Diego John at some point. And he gives us the tape. It was, you know, VHS tape at the time. So I wrote the music to it, and I hit every single punch. And it was like a fight scene that where there's all kinds of, you know, punching and kicking. I musically hit every single thing, and I was so proud that, you know, I got all over, you know. And I showed it to the teacher, and he's like, "No, you don't have to hit everything." And I realized, you know, that that's sort of a, they call it Mickey Mousing, where you're like, you know, making it like an old Bugs Bunny cartoon, where you're like, everything is accentuated. And I realized at the time that, you know, that doesn't have quite the effect that I wanted it to have. You can rely more on sound effects to have those, have the certain impact. You can't, don't try to do everything, don't try to be the sound effects. Let the sound effects be the sound effects. And you kind of create something that drives the scene right beneath the surface, and maybe kind of choreographs it, makes everything feel like it's part of this big dance. So the 16th notes is kind of a part of that. I always often add some sort of a rhythmically driven figure in things. Thank you. Sure. Other questions? So the process, to continuing the process, once I write the piece, the next step is getting it orchestrated for the orchestra. And that's when I'm working on something for the director, I'll tend to, like a cinematic where there are directors who are wanting to hear something like a fully polished cinematic that would be very, I'll add a lot of detail to it. Sometimes, like it often sounds so close to the real thing that, you know, what they're basically wanting is to know, once they get it to a point where there's no room for interpretation, it sounds exactly the way they want it to sound, then we take it to the stage, and then it adds, you know, an extra layer of energy, realism, and excitement. So Oftentimes, I spend a lot of time working on the mock-up, making it sound as realistic as possible. And then with the indie music, I don't have to spend quite as much time, but I do. That's my orchestration process, at least from the MIDI side of things. Meaning, some people rely on orchestrators to really flesh out the music quite a bit. You know, if you get like a little piano sketch, the orchestrator will turn it into a full score. There's a lot of arranging happening there. In my case, my orchestrator that's not really what she does. So she's more about translating the MIDI and the mock-up into the orchestra. So it's not like she decides to add a flute line or a oboe line or something. Like, all of that's in what I do. But what she does is she takes that mock-up and then takes like a string track. I'll do like a full string track for all the strings rather than do first, second, violin, viola, cello, like break it out like that because I often don't have time. I also use a expression pedal. I have two pedals. One is a volume pedal and one is a kind of expression pedal. And I'll play in the strings with two hands, sort of like do the full chords, full section stuff. And I'm able to, with my feet, kind of create the expression globally for everything. Taking the time to do one, violin section at a time, and then add in all the expression information after the fact is two times.
Mogwheel?
I use Mogwheel as well, but oftentimes if it's easy to do, I'll usually just send that to the foot pedal and do it that way anyways, just so I can, be drinking a nice tea with my left hand. But I learned that in working in TV with the foot pedal thing because we didn't have time to do, all that. Doing one section at a time is really about to get one full section performance. I learned a lot of shortcuts working in TV and that has informed my process to this day. So I'll do this full string section on the keyboard, and then my orchestrator will take it and split it out into the individual sections, decide, how many violins are going to be on the top note and such, add dynamics, bowings, articulations, things like that. And then she sends me back the score, and I go over it in great detail, one, just to make sure that the mock-up I sent accurately conveyed my ideas. Oftentimes, dynamics, like, there'll be little swells here and there that didn't come through in the MIDI that I'll have her add in. But it's also, when I'm going over the score, I want to know it inside and out. So when I'm on the stage producing it, my orchestrator isn't there. I have to know it inside and out. And then, so I'll go through and I'll read every line, make sure I know exactly what's going to happen, and a little bit back and forth, I'll give her some notes and ask. I take every time I have somebody orchestrate music for me, it's a learning experience. And I always ask them if they make a decision to do something, like they'll add something that doesn't make sense to me or that I've never seen done, I'll say, well, why don't you do that? Just out of curiosity. Oftentimes I'll learn something new. So once the score has been created, then it gets sent off to a copyist who makes the individual parts of the orchestra, and also they act as a librarian, which means they're the ones responsible for putting those parts out on the stands and collecting them afterwards. And if somehow one part is missing, they'll print it and quickly get it out there. Or if we need to add or change a part, they'll quickly have that done. Once we record everything, I work with an engineer named John Kurlander, who recorded the Lord of the Rings scores, and he's a legend, and I feel so grateful every time I get to work with him. Again, it's a learning experience. I watch what he does, I ask a lot of questions, and just want to understand why he does what he does, because he's a legend. He worked with the Beatles. He's just an amazing engineer. So he does these live mixes, which he ahead of time does these detailed plans where everyone's going to sit down to the inch. And he has it all mapped out. He knows where every mic's going to be. He gets a ruler out. He makes sure that the microphone is exactly the same height every time. So there's consistency. Like if we record on the same project months later, it'll sound exactly the same because he's planned like that. So as we were recording, he's kind of doing a live mix, and kind of based on having worked together, you know, as many times as we have, kind of know what to expect. And if the piece is a little bit different, if there's, you know, might be like a harp solo in it or something, I'll mention it to him. He can kind of play with the level a little bit. But when he does these stereo mixes of the orchestra that I then take, and I'll sometimes combine, you know, if time permits, I'll sometimes record the strings on their own, and I'll have the full orchestra pass, and then I'll double the strings, just give a fuller section, or I'll, you know, double the horns, or if there's something I need to come out a little more, I'll sometimes have it played on its own so I can isolate that and bring it out a little more. I layer those on top of each other and do all the editing, because the orchestra, sometimes we give a luxurious amount of time to record something, have to do it, you know, absolutely perfect. Sometimes we have to move kind of quickly, and we'll have to kind of settle for things that don't sound perfect. So rhythmically, it's oftentimes, as I mentioned, I really like the rhythmic stuff, especially kind of futuristic. There's sort of a modern sound now. There's a lot of music, like all Hans Zimmer stuff. It's sort of this very almost computer-like rhythm in the strings and stuff. And that doesn't happen naturally. To a certain degree, it does, but there's oftentimes someone in there kind of nudging every note, making sure everything sounds absolutely perfect. And I do appreciate a certain amount of human feel, but with rhythmic stuff, I'm often very like picky about how I want to be. So, and in my case, it's me doing it. I have tried sending it off to people who don't completely know exactly what I'm going for, and I, you know, to a fault, I tend to want to do everything myself, because that's the music comes together in that process for me. You know, it's not just about the composition, it's about the, how the sounds work together and how it sounds rhythmically, and I might decide midway through the process that I want to try something different. So I tend to not want to rely on other people to make those decisions for me, and in the process end up not getting a lot of sleep. Something I'm working on. But so once everything gets edited in and all the takes are, I find, you know, we might record 3 or 4 takes of something, or if we're lucky, maybe 10 takes of something. But going through it, and it gets to the point where, you know, there might be like this trumpet section that's perfect for 2 bars, and then not so great for the next 2 bars, but it's good on another take. So kind of comping those takes together, all of this is done in Pro Tools, which we recorded initially, and then I do all the editing. So combine all those elements, and then I mix in the samples, because oftentimes, like, again, kind of it's kind of a Hans Zimmer thing, where oftentimes now samples are combined with orchestra, because orchestra has, there are certain things orchestra does very well, but if you want a bigger-than-life sound, if you want that rhythmic precision, sometimes I'll do something like kind of very rhythmically precise in the strings, that adding a little bit of samples on top of that will the ear hears the air and the liveness of the strings, but the samples create that rhythmic precision. So the two together create something that neither of them could have achieved on their own. So once everything's mixed together, sometimes if they just want a stereo mix, I'll send off stereo stems of everything. And if they want a 5-1 mix, we'll go in and kind of get everything panned just right and output it that way. But that's more or less the process, you know, at least for the cinematic stuff. The in-game stuff is a little more, it's a little freer. As I mentioned, got opportunity to explore musical ideas a little more. You know, starts with a kind of a rough sketch. I'll try to find like just a melodic idea to start with, and then build the piece around that. I'll start with like almost a cell of a melody and kind of build that, and then I'll add an intro to it or an outro. And it does, for my stuff tends to be a little bit song-like. Partially, I was started out in a rock band, and you know, wanted to be a heavy metal guitar god, you know, back in the day. I looked up to all the, you know, players, and so I don't have a classical background as much as, you know, some of my colleagues. You know, I never taken a composition class. I've never studied. I studied, you know, harmony and musicianship and orchestration, things like that. But I never, the compositional process has always been very intuitive and sort of by ear for me. And as much as I regret that to a certain degree, I regret not having the opportunity to study it as much as I would have. I kind of ended up getting a lot more real world experience. Like, rather than go to school, I went to school for a certain time, then had the opportunity to start working for composers early on. So I started doing that. So if I had to do it over again, I might have studied more. But at this point, I'm kind of trying to embrace the things that I might have seen as faults in the past, and I'm trying to kind of embrace the fact that because I don't have a rigid classical background, it allows me to explore, you know, the electronic and rock side a little more. I kind of feel relatively comfortable right in the middle, where I can do a certain amount of orchestral writing, a certain amount of electronic and rock stuff, and kind of bring the two together. So, so I'm taking my weakness and making it hopefully a strength, or at least something I can draw from, rather than let it, you know, bring me down. So, any other questions?
What's one of your favorite scores?
That one right there, probably. And it's funny how you often don't think about it at the time when it's happening. Like as I mentioned, it was like the sort of last minute thing. This I had been working on it for months. Similarly to the other thing I mentioned, they presented it to me and they said, "Here's this thing." And I saw the rough cut with hand drawn storyboards and everything. And I thought, this is a great story. I'm really looking forward to doing this, but it was also kind of intimidating. So, like, I was working on other projects at the time and kind of let some time go by. And then, you know, the deadline is looming, and it's like, I need to get on this. And I started getting on it. And then, you know, we were kind of focusing on earlier parts of it. And I sort of scoring it chronologically. So the earlier parts, we get kind of bogged down with, like, certain things. Oh, it's, you know, the electronic stuff needs a little more of this, a little more of that. And so we're kind of focusing on those details. Meanwhile, the end is getting, you know, not getting the attention it needs. It's the most important part of the thing. And then they give me another piece to work on, and I have to, a piece that's not due for another couple months, but we have the opportunity to record it with the orchestra. So I get a head start on that, just kind of block out a small amount so we can have something to record. Meanwhile, I'm not working on this piece again. And then, you know, time keeps going, and I'm just, sometimes for certain things you have to be in a certain headspace to really, for it to get inspired and for it to work the way you want it to work. And so it seemed like a lot of time went by, and then next thing you know, the session was coming up, and again, it was kind of focused on earlier parts of the piece, getting them orchestrated, getting them ready for the stage. Meanwhile, the end was, you know, a few days from recording, and I just all of a sudden, something broke through, and it all came out like in almost real time, like that. The whole ending 3 minutes I probably wrote in one day, which is like, I've written enormous amounts of music in one day, and I've taken, you know, a year to write a relatively small amount of music, and it's the times that you're inspired and it flows, you know, completely effortlessly. That's the best part about the process, and I chase that every time. I try to find it. How can I get back to that place that where things flow so freely? And that's the challenge. It's always a matter of kind of creating an environment that creativity can flow. And the way I've tried to do that over the years is kind of removing clutter from my life, from my workspace. You know, if you have clutter in your mind and you're thinking about, you know, oh, I gotta pay this bill or that bill, and like stressful things that aren't related to the music, that's just gonna kind of, it's clutter, obstacles, you're gonna have to get over that before you can get to that place. I find that having like a bunch bunch of junk around my workspace. Like, I'll spend a certain amount of time every day, like, cleaning up and, like, moving things and just making sure, you know, getting everything taken care of. There's emails that need to be taken care of. I'll take care of those. I would have them, you know, things looming in my mind that need to get taken care of. Once all that's, you know, done, then that's one less thing in my mind that I'm thinking about. So oftentimes I end up writing late at night because, you know, spent all day getting all this other stuff out of the way. And I'm getting really getting started, like at 7 or 8 at night, sometimes 10 o'clock at night, and then work all night, which isn't great because, you know, you're on a completely different wavelength from the rest of the world, and, you know, makes it challenging. But that seems to be the only time that I really can get my brain quiet enough that I can hear the music, I can hear, I can, you're sort of allowing the, you know, creativity shows up when, you know, the environment is just right, and it never happens when you force it to, when you want it to happen so much. The only way it will happen when you want it to happen is when you create, you strategically create an environment or a time or some kind of a workspace that allows that to come through in a you know, create just the right environment to allow it to come in, and then, you know, don't push it, don't force it to come. Oftentimes I'll be working late at night and I'll feel like I have to just push through, maybe I can get this idea down, and I'm really struggling. I more and more over the years have realized that if you take a strategic break and come back to it later, even though it feels like you don't have time to do that, if you come back to it later, chances are you're going to be working faster when you do, so you'll make up the time you lose by taking that break. That's kind of always been sort of fine-tuning that process over the years, and oftentimes I'm working on seven different games at the same time, and it's really a very delicate balance of, you know, creating just the right environment, even within my own brain, just my own thoughts, like organizing my thoughts and like how I try not to I don't focus on the other six when I'm working on the one. Maybe it's a little bit in the back of my mind, but, you know, trying not to. And then, you know, you can compartmentalize and move between projects and then kind of focus on whoever is, you know, whichever client is screaming the loudest, you know, give them something first. And then I've never missed a deadline. And the only way, sometimes the only way that has happened is that I've asked for help and I've had people come in and bail me out. But it's important to not, you know, disappoint clients. You know, I think I'm jumping around randomly here, so stop me if anything. One of the things, the secrets to career longevity for me has been making sure that you be easy to work with. You know, check your ego at the door, because there's no room in even less so in games, I think. Games tend to be very, you know, team driven, and there's a lot of, you know, games will people work in cubicles and they're working programming and doing, you know, art, writing, all these different people. It's not like on in a movie where you have this big action star or this big movie star comes in and then there's like a lot of people, a lot of egos involved in the film world. It's a lot different in the game world in my experience. So ego is even, not that ego does you any good in the film industry either, but much less so in the game world. So yeah, be easy to work with, and, you know, because if you're working, you want to be the easiest part of your client's day. If they're, you know, stressing out about various things, deadlines, they have other people they're working with, you want to be the easiest part of that for them. Often my producers that I work with will say, "You're so easy to work with. I have this major headache with so and so," and that's entirely intentional, because I could, you know, complain and say, "Oh, you know, I can't work like this, and you know, all these revisions are driving me crazy." I can say that, but I've gotten enough jobs because they had fired someone else that had, you know, had some kind of issue or was, you know, being a diva, you know, that I realized at some point, like, I need to be the easiest. amazing part of their day, and they'll keep coming back to you because you know, if you look, think about it, like if you, like you hire a plumber or someone to work on your house and they're a pain and they charge a ridiculous amount of money and they don't do a good job, you're never going to call them. So I try to be, you know, deliver high quality, exceed their expectations. It's always important, you know, on no matter what project. I worked on terrible, low-budget films that I wrote this, I scored them like it was like the best film I'd ever seen, like the best thing ever. Because I knew that, you know, if I wrote down to the picture that, you know, what, it's not going to do anyone any good. It's not going to help my career. It's not going to help the film. It's not going to help the director. If I do the best job I can, then maybe that director will hire me for the next thing. And the next thing, and maybe the projects will get better and better, which eventually they have. You know, just do the best you can on everything, and you're not going to get another chance. If you half-ass it, you're not going to get another chance. So you always do the best you can. And it's, I know that's obvious, but you know, I've heard people talk about, now this, you know, I was really into the project, so I just kind of, you know, just gave them whatever. I've never done that. The only time I've ever had to compromise is when just, you know, have all these different projects converging at the same time, and I've had to bring in some help to finish it off, but even then, I you know, did the absolute best that I could to make it, you know, the best that I could with the resources and time I have. So I think it's important because, you know, incrementally, if you're probably gonna, if you work enough in the industry long enough, you're gonna develop a reputation. It's up to you what that reputation is. You know, plenty of people have, you know, reputations. This guy, he always gets drunk at the parties, you know, he's, you know, that's what people think and remember about. I want to be the guy that is remembered because he always works hard and always, you know, delivers top-notch, you know, product, because that's going to kind of go out, send ripples out into the industry. People hear your work and they eventually come looking for you. And that's been something that's happened to me in the last, you know, 3 or 4 years. It went from me like chasing down people, you know, trying to get them to listen to my work and kind of trying to make the opportunities happen, to now people start coming to me and asking me to do their thing because they've heard my work before. And that took a long time to get to. It took me, you know, 17 years of working my ass off every day to get to the point where people started coming to me to work with me. And it doesn't happen every day. So I still have some more work to do, but you know, the fact that it's happened at all, it shows me that I'm doing something right at some point. Any question?
Yeah, I'm asking more about the potential for the company. Because you work on almost every game from business.
Yeah.
And you know, they're very different from university to university. Warcraft is a very, very big, immersive game. Mm-hmm. The line between, you know, right and wrong is very blurry in that game. Whereas in something like Diablo, it's a very one-dimensional game. Mm-hmm. The eternal conflict of, you know, the light and the bad, the darkness and the light, of course. In like something like StarCraft, it's even more important. It's, you know, there are three, you know, properties, and how do you reflect that, you know, in your music? Because, you know, if it's Warcraft, given in different dimensions, I can hear, oh, that's you know, that's Warcraft. And you know, so how do you reflect that in your
great question. Yeah, stylistically, you have, and it comes down to that thing I was talking about, defining your palette. You know, with Warcraft, there's a lot more kind of Iron Age. The tonality tends to be not as complex. The tends to be very, you picture Conan the Barbarian, which, you know, the original World War II soundtrack was loosely based on. You know, at least it was an influence. You know, not so much like, hey, we're going to copy this, but definitely it was an influence. And even more, and on Worlds of Draenor, that kind of came up again. Like someone said, "Hey, you know, we're really thinking about that Conan the Barbarian sound. You know, you sort of have that. You know, you have a lot of percussion, you have a lot of brass-driven things. The palette is sort of defined, and it helps to come onto a project that's already been, you know, there's been 10 years, 20 years of Warcraft, so." You come onto it, there's been a lot of stuff already established. which is it's both a blessing and a curse. Now, it's a blessing because you have all this material to draw from. And then the curse is how you step into something that the fans love so much and have a very specific idea of what they want and expect to hear, and how do you add to that and expand on that? And that's something I've had the opportunity to do and had the challenge of doing, and I'm grateful that it's been well received over the years. But a lot of it, it's because I never try to forget what came before. I always pay attention to everything that led up to that. I try to make it sound like it's an extension of what was there before. So, and it's good to be able to rely on the writers and the development team, directors to kind of tell me at any given moment, like, what's the focus right now? And each, you know, like you mentioned, there's all these different, you know, the Horde, the Alliance, you know, sometimes it's not really, my daughter comes and watches what I'm working on, she's like, who's the bad guy? Like, well, there is no bad guy. You know, this one side's doing this one thing, this other side's, both of them believe that they're doing the right thing. And so how do you score that, you know, how do you create the differentiation musically? And it's really, it comes down to a scene-by-scene basis or kind of focus on one particular area. And then, you know, StarCraft, you know, it's similar, but we tend to focus more on electronic sounds or kind of augmented palette like that, or even ethnic vocals, different things. It's kind of try to keep each of these worlds as different from each other as possible. Sometimes someone will call me out and say, oh, this sound just like that other game, and, you know, it's all coming from the same brain. Oftentimes I'm working on the same pieces back to back, and it's difficult to make it sound night and day different. Thank you.
I think we have only till 4 o'clock-ish, so if there's like one other piece of music you want to play,
sure.
Or anything else.
We're out of 4, you said?
I think so.
Okay, well, any questions?
How did you get to Revelation?
Well, how did I get to do Revelation?
Yeah, you get through Blizzard as well?
No, it's actually, so Revelation is a Chinese game I did about 3 years ago, and that was, I actually wrote the music 3 years ago. It's still officially not out outside of China. It's in beta right now. But so this was a Chinese game for the. So I had to write the score for a Chinese game. It was a Chinese sounding score, and it was for the Chinese market. So as a Western composer, it's, you know, it's very a challenge and a difficult thing to do. I think I was like one of the second people to score a Chinese video game that wasn't Chinese, so, or at least it was from the West. So that came about, the company that was making the game had a deal with my agent, actually it was the China Film Group, who does most of the films in China, had a deal with them, because they had a lot of film composers and the idea was that they were going to have American composers score Chinese films. And the company that was making the game came to the China Film Group and said, we want a composer, like a cinematic composer that has like a movie sound. Do you have anyone? And they're like, well, we have this deal with this, you know, American agency. We can talk to them, because I think up until then there had been laws in place that didn't allow Chinese companies to work with Americans. So that had recently changed, and so all of a sudden it opened up the, you know, opportunity to work with, you know, work across the world. And so they said, do you have anyone that has video game experience, that has a cinematic sound, that, you know, they didn't ask for it, but it helped that I had worked on Mist of Pandaria a couple years before, which is, you know, very Chinese driven. So kind of had all these things going for me, and that opened the door to do it. And it's one of those things, like, up until then, I hadn't scored a game on my own. I've always been part of a team. And they came to me and they said, you want this very large scope score that I was going to do entirely by myself. And, you know, it's like, at the time, I'm thinking, you know, how did I go from being, you know, one of the members of the team to now doing my whole thing? But I never let them know at any time that I had self-doubt or that I was, you know, are you sure you have the right guy for this? I just, you know, at every step of the way told them that, you know, inspire confidence and told them that, you know, oh yeah, it's going to be great, we're going to do this and that, and kind of get them excited about the ideas. Meanwhile, like, you know, frantically researching, trying to figure out how I can pull this off. And, you know, it ended up leading the way to, you know, five or six more projects from that same company. So, yeah. And again, it's the same kind of thing I was talking about, like, these opportunities come, you never know where they're going to come from, so you just, you know, do your best in every step of the way.
Curious, so you get the clip, and then you watch the clip, and then you have to come up with music.
Yeah.
And how do you decide, like, the key, or if you use like some special scales, is it just like go with the mood?
Yeah, good question. And the key, you know, it's often C or D, or like I have go-to just because my fingers, you know, get used to doing it, having holding certain shapes on the keyboard. And I try to fight that too, and I try to think, you know, sometimes I'll just sit there and just kind of like listen quietly, and then sometimes a note will pop in my head, and that note is in some different key I haven't worked with, and I build it around that. Or if, then the thing is, the question is, once you get in that key, how do you decide when and where to transpose from that? There's, you know, strategic things, like if you're working on a scene and you want things to kind of progress to the next level, you might, you know, transpose up a whole step, and then all of a sudden you have that same relative feeling, but now it's kind of heightened slightly. You know, just kind of picking moments when the drama shifts or things happen that, you know, transpose, and kind of you want the feeling of the music to change, then you do that accordingly. But a lot of it's, yeah, sort of intuition. A lot of it's just, you know, habit and intuition are the first things they kind of...
When you start with the melody or the composition?
Depending on the project, but yeah, I mean, try to, you know, melody's very important to me, so I always try to get that established early on. Or sometimes on a project, the melody won't come until later, and I'll then go back and work it through the whole thing, because it's important to... Especially on short things like this, if you're scoring a whole film, you have 2 hours to develop that melody and to get it, you know, to the point where when the audience hears it, they're gonna have that association or that maybe an emotional impact of hearing it. I have 4 minutes to achieve that same thing. So whenever the moment is where the melody is the payoff moment, if I haven't built up to it, you know, throughout the whole thing, then I will go back and make sure that happens. Add a tiny hint of it at the very beginning and have certain moments. And make it feel inevitable. So when it does eventually come, it's like, oh, I know that melody, even though you only heard it 4 minutes ago. Mm-hmm. You have a question?
Yeah, is there an instrument or a genre that is the most challenging for you to write for?
That's a good question. It's hard to say because whenever I get asked to do something I haven't done before, I just immerse myself in it and I try to learn everything I can about it. I think that the next thing I'm doing, I mentioned, you know, having trouble getting started on, sort of like goes into an area that I haven't, you know, a more classical side of things that I haven't, you know, done as much of. So I'm finding, you know, just immersing myself, listening to a lot of music and studying, and just kind of, once I have it's completely saturated, and I can hear it, you know, when I'm sleeping, then it comes out fairly easily. Like with Asian music, the first one I did, the revelation actually that I missed the Pandaria, the World of Warcraft one, I had never done anything like that before. And it's like all of a sudden, write this, you know, completely, you know, Asian sounding score. So listen to a lot of stuff. You know, I had been listening to it my whole life, you know, with movies and that kind of stuff, but like to actually immerse myself in it to the point where I can sit down and start playing something from a different culture and not having the sound, you know, have it sound fairly natural, it took a lot of immersion listening, studying of the scales, and, any other questions?
Any other questions?
What sound libraries do you like to use?
For brass, tenor brass, for strings, for legato strings, cinematic strings 2.0, for I think getting into the Berlin stuff as well is kind of slowly, it's such a massive library with all these different articulations kind of slowly kind of going through it. For the rhythmic, like spiccato strings, I use LA scoring strings layered with adagio, like a bunch of different things, because oftentimes I'll find that one library doesn't do everything I want it to do, doesn't have quite the sound, so I'll layer several libraries on top of each other. Percussion, I use Cineperk, also still use some stuff from True Strike, from Project Sam, but relatively old, but still has a nice room sound to it. It has, you know, sounds like it's recorded in the back of the room, which, you know, is how it's supposed to sound. Winds, I use the Vienna instruments, they have like a little bit of auto solos and stuff. Yeah, I mean, the palette isn't, I don't have all the latest, newest sounds. I prefer to get to know a sound and be able to, you know, use it without having to think about it. And then at some point, I get busy and years go by and all of a sudden, you know, I've got a lot of catching up to do and I have to go, you know, update everything because obviously the sound quality has increased dramatically over the years.
I think, I'm not sure if this, we can keep talking, but I know the class typically ends at 4 o'clock. If anybody, we can continue this out in the main lobby, or if anybody asks any more questions for Neil, or anything like that, or wants to talk further, we can hang out there for just a couple minutes. Otherwise, thank you so much.